Welcome back to Worth the Effort Woodworking. Today we're going to finish up the wall cabinet we started yesterday. Yesterday we built a door for a glass panel that my sister created. Now normally when I'm building a cabinet, the first thing I do is I build a case so that I can fit the door to the case. We did it differently this way because the focal point of the cabinet was this piece of glass art my sister created in her studio up in North Texas. She has a really nice glass one, and she can build custom glass panels for woodworkers like me. Check her out, hcartistry.com. Anyways, this was going to be the focal piece for the entire thing, so the dimensions of the cabinet had to be based off of that. Hence, I went ahead and built the door first. Plus, I wanted to figure out a unique way to capture the window, because it does have variation. These fused glass panels, these melted glass panels, they aren't consistent like we get from the store, so you just can't fit them into a quarter inch dado. So that's what we did yesterday. Now I stopped yesterday at the point where we were about to start gluing things up, because if y'all follow me for a while, you know I hate measuring with a tape measure. So I'm gonna use this door, the components of the door, to size up the rest of the panels for this piece. So let's start doing that one, sizing up the last of the panels we dimensioned yesterday. Let's head on out to the shop annex. Attention while I dimensioned that lumber, because did you notice I was not cutting two long pieces and two short pieces? I was alternating in between them. This is why, and this is one of those things that it's, you can tell a person who's really thought through his project versus one who's just trying to get it done. The grain will now match all the way around the board. Now unfortunately I did not find a board long enough to get all the pieces out of it, so I had one separate board, probably came from a different tree, but I tried to cut it as close as I could to get as close a grain pattern as I want. Now this joint right here will not match perfectly, so I would probably put this in a corner that wouldn't be noticed. For example, if I knew where the cabinet was going, say in the bathroom, and people would be looking up from it most of the time, sitting on a toilet, I would probably put this in the top corner, maybe next to a wall. That way, when they observe from the top to the sides, it would be continuous. Now, this is going to end up being a painted piece, except I'm not going to paint the interior. So I'm going to flip it this time. I'm going to try and get the grain to match up on the inside of the piece instead of the outside. And this section right here will probably be a bottom corner, which I have another secret for in the future. Thank you. believe that there is probably a subgroup of y'all out there that the moment I started doing dovetails, you started saying to yourself, I can't do this one. This one ain't a basic project. Well, I'm here to tell you, a dovetail is a basic joint. This is a beginner level project. This is simply through dovetails, cutting to the line, chopping out what you don't need. It really is simple. You can do this kind of stuff on your first project. Yeah, maybe you don't want to cut the dovetail into your good wood right off the bat. Go grab a scrap piece. Cut your first dovetail. Go in and show your spouse. They'll look at you like you're crazy. You join two pieces of wood. No big deal. They get it. It's no big deal. You can do it. Maybe they go out, try it again if your confidence is waning a little bit. I guarantee that first one will probably take you an hour. The second one, maybe half an hour. Third one, if you really need a confidence boost, maybe 25, 20 minutes. This isn't a hard joint to learn. It is literally just coloring within the lines. And I have faith in you. I believe that with the power above, you can send electricity to your hands and move them back and forth repeatedly, over and over. I believe you have the power to literally strike a mallet with a chisel without bodily damage. I believe in you. You can do this. Just try. If you're still apprehensive about it, just get over it. Go out in the workshop. Try it. I think that's why a lot of snobs like me kind of disdain pocket hole joinery. We see people doing them all over the place. It isn't because it's a bad joint. There's actually good applications for pocket hole joinery. Right off the top of my head, attaching tabletops, putting two screws in to the center section, then watering out the holes on the outside section, it'll hold a nice small tabletop just perfectly. That's what that joint is designed to do. Not assembling a case like this, which is going to hold weight. Basically, you're then building IKEA furniture. Those screws are going to waller out. They're going to loosen up. You're going to have to tighten them up. And 5 years out down the road, it'll get so loose, they'll end up on the dumpster. Hey, if you're spending the time to build something that'll last generations. And a dovetail is the way to go. And why we disdain those kind of misapplications for simple joinery such as screws, nails, is that we know how easy it is to do it right. So, get out in the shop. Try it if you are apprehensive about it. This is a basic joint. It's basic. You can do it. Okay, next step in this project is I'm going to dimension up some half-inch wood from this stuff. Basically, I'm going to be dimensioning the shelves and the backslide, and a personal preference, I think if you have a thinner shelf than a case, it just looks better. Now, I'm going to do these to just a little over a half-inch for no other reason than I can still use my half-inch chisel to get out the waste. I'll then make a groove on the top, hiding it behind the dovetails for the backslats. And then we'll come back and I will show you how to install drawers in a very basic way using basic tools, something that you can do, and make them really secure. So, let's get dimensioning some more wood. We'll be right back. had the carcass done. This is the back side of the carcass. I've got groove on the top and the bottom, and I have two slats that I built up with a half lap in the middle. What's going to happen is I'm going to glue one side and the other side. I'm not going to glue the bottom. So as they move, because they're going across the grain here, those overlaps will move as they want to go, and it'll just lock in. And having it glued on either side, meaning it'll close in the center, but you won't see any gap on the edge. So now it's time for us to decide on the shelving and how we're going to all lay it out. Now, I'm not going to be putting shelving just dead even. I'm going to size it for an average size book. So that way somebody can have two shelves for a book, and I'll have a bottom shelf that we can do something else with if we want to. Hint, hint, future video. Oh, and by the way, The Essential Woodworker by Robert Waring, really good book. Anyways, this board right here was the one that did not match. These three came out of the same board, and we have it grain matched on the interior. So I want to put the hinge on that side. This is the back, so that when people open up the bookcase, if it happens to be empty, they will notice the grain going around. They won't really see this side. Though it matches okay, it's just not perfect, and we want them to see the best we've got. So I'm going to do this for a right-handed person. So once again, I'm going to put the hinge on that side so they open up and see the nice grain match, which means that this is now the top of the drawer. So now from here, we can size out how we want to do the drawers. Now, if you're just getting into woodworking, have a little money to burn, and are looking for your first specialty plane, I cannot recommend a router plane enough. Get the big one. Don't get the little one. These and a bunch of manufacturers make these little ones. There really isn't that much of a price difference between the two. And you will use the big one a lot more, and you can get the different size blades on it, so it can do the same things a small one will. But just having the bigger base makes things so much easier. Now I want you to think about it. How many times have you seen me use this tool in just this project alone? It is so nice if you have to ever go to a specific depth, and that's what a router plane is. It's basically a blade coming down from the top. It's a very safe tool. You can let kids use it, and it just makes your work so much more professional when you can just get the depths of things just dead on perfect. Now we're going to be making a dado to house our shelves, and they're going to go into these boards. So I'm going to be using this router plane to do it. And remember me saying that I made the shelves just a tad bit bigger than a half inch because of my chisel? Well, both my chisel and this plane have half inch blades in them. So I'll make it sliding in and out a lot easier. And because this is going to be the master depth, I'm also going to use this as my marking gauge. No sense in setting up two different tools, just more of a chance of human error. So just use this as your marking gauge at the same time. So let's go ahead and lay out where the shelves are going to be going. Okay, I've created a nick on one board, and I transferred it to the other board, so I have two nicks for the top of each shelf at the exact same place on both boards. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to create what's called a knife line. I've got my knife, and my line is not going to go all the way across. Now, in my beginner level classes, I would go all the way across, and you would see the mortise, the dado, on the front of the cabinet. On this one, I'm going to do a stop dado so it's nice and flat. The side rows will look better this way. And this is just because I might want to sell this one. So, I'm going to make a knife line. I'm going to make a very light knife line. I am not touching very hard. Do this a couple times. Each subsequent time, I'm going a little bit harder, because I want a fairly deep knife line at the end. And this is going to be the top of the shelf. So there we have a fairly deep knife line there. Going to come up to the front and do the same thing. Come back over. Very light. You do it light so because you don't want to move the ruler. You just want to kind of kiss the top of it to create a ledge. And then each subsequent one will be a little bit harder. And just because I know I'll screw it up if I don't do it, I'm putting a pencil line on the part of the wood I'm going to be removing. Now I'm going to do the other board the exact same way. Okay, so I've got the two lines there. I did the pencil line on where it's going to be marked out. So now I'm going to mark the baseline for what I'm doing. So I am going to first, since this is the back of it, I don't really care if it looks pencil mark or line marks. I would just want to preserve the front. So I'm going to transfer the line directly from that nick, and that's why I use a nick, because it's very easy to find. Transfer that line down on all the boards. And if you remember, I said I put a half inch router blade in that router. So now, in order to mark the depth, all I need to do is put my router blade right on that edge and roll it around. And it'll create a nice depth line. So now that I got the depth that my shelves need to be, remember I kind of guesstimated, so I don't know the exact measurement. I need to go cut my shelves to width. So basically I'm going to take this distance and add twice of that. And I'll go a little bit short because this won't be showing, so I'll have a little bit of an air gap on the inside for glue to settle. So let's go cut those shelves. Y'all might be asking, why did we have to get those shelves perfectly sized before we cut the dado? Well, we don't actually know how thick those shelves were. As I said, I just made them a little bit more than a half inch so that I could use the tools I have. And since we don't know the exact size, how can we get a router bit or anything machine made to work? So we are going to basically take the measurement directly off of the piece. And the first step to doing that is creating a V-notch, using that knife line as the bottom of the V-notch. So just sharpen up a chisel. I prefer getting a larger chisel for this one. This one I'm using right now is a 1-incher. And just work your way down, knocking off that triangle until you get to the very back. With that done, I can now come in, kind of turn my shelf on its edge, and bring it up, and it will kind of notch into that little triangle we just created. And then if you just bring it up, a little pressure against that triangle, now we can mark a perfect fitting shelf. And in actuality, because we have it at just a few degrees out of an angle, we are making this dado a fraction of a bit too small. That way, when we assemble it, we will compress these fibers a little bit as we push it in, and it'll make it fit even snugger. Okay, I'm going to try and show you two ways of doing this. One way I was taught, and I'm told that this is the proper way, and the other way I do just because I'm lazy and it's a little bit quicker for me. You can decide which one's the best way. The first way is the official way, and basically we are going to continue down with these V-notches until we get a little pyramid, and then we're going to use a chisel to get rid of the center section of the pyramid. Now this is the one instance where I find having one massive chisel makes life a little bit easier. You can do it all with your half inch chisel, no big deal. You'll just be doing a tad bit more work. Having the 1-inch, the big old, I think this is 2 inches actually, just makes chopping straight lines a little bit easier. And this is the largest one I got in my set that I bought to test out, and this is the only use I've ever found for it. So, judge for yourself whether it's worth the investment. Now in the traditional method, the first thing you do is deepen your knife line with a couple chisel whacks. And that is why having this long chisel makes life a little bit easier. Now, if you're on a super soft wood, you can't just attack it too hard in the beginning, because a chisel is a wedge and it is going to want to equalize pressure on both sides. So since the angle's this way and one's this way, it will tend to push over that way. But if you've already got a line started with the initial knife line and the V cut, well, it should be okay. From here, just take your V cut a little bit deeper. And then it's just a matter of rinse and repeat until you get to your depth, which is going to leave a pyramid at the top that we'll get rid of with both the chisel and the router plane. Okay, here's where I want my dado to stop. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to come back a little bit and with very light taps, because it wouldn't be too hard to just split the whole thing in half. I'm going to sever these fibers up into that line. And then I'm going to slowly take out those sections, being careful not to blow out this end. And I will keep going down until I get well past the depth I want to go to. This is just being done with hand pressure. And now I can continue removing the chisel, holding this front hand, holding my chisel back a little bit with my back hand providing the propulsion. Then just kind of keep whittling your way down until you get to the depth you want. You might need to come back in certain sections, sever the fibers a little bit more. You might be asking yourself, why are we doing all this work with a chisel if we had that router plane? Well, I hate to tell you this, as cool as I think that router plane is, it is a bit of a prissy tool. It's only going to take off that last little bit. So we've got to kind of get rid of everything but that last little bit using just our muscles. Now, before you get the router plane, be sure you clear off your wood, because the router plane will just make a bunch of scratches if you don't. And here we go. That looks like I gotta go a little bit more. It's taking too big a bite. Yep, a little bit more with a chisel. And then just kind of ease your way down, trying not to touch the two sides. And that will guarantee that you reach your full depth. Now, I did this just for a demonstration, because that's the way I was taught to do it, and it seems to work. And if you're limited on low practice, this is guaranteed to get it done. But what I don't like about it is, you saw that, even I chipped out a little bit on the side, just random chisel bouncing off and lifting up fibers. And I think it's just too slow. It takes forever. To me, I would rather saw out the middle. And just grab yourself a carcass saw. Okay? And have at it. Now, if you need a little crutch, there's no reason why you can't take a straight edge, clamp it down, and give yourself a fence to saw on. I know some people will use a kerfing saw for making these kinds of cuts. It's all up to you. Me, I just say, get a little gumption and go for it. You got a line, solder the line. And once again, I want to give you a few options. The trick I found is your saw, that first tooth, you want it to be flat. You don't want it to be angled back because it'll act as a little scraper. And I learned that trick from floats. A float, the most important tooth on the float is that first one because that does most of the work that as you're cutting along. So use the same technique for a saw because basically a float is just a wide saw. Now the two points you need to keep taking consideration is your stop, I've penciled in right here, and your depth on the backside. Now if you're doing a through cut, it's no big deal. In fact, I've seen saws where they'll drill holes in the plate and have a wood beam that can come down so that drops your thickness so you can't go too far thick. You just got to saw a straight line. But I don't want to go do it through dado, so I want to stop it there, and that's where that first tooth comes into account. So I come back to the back, use my normal sawing techniques. Now a saw, as strange as this might sound, actually does want to follow a straight line. It does not want to curve. You actually have to make it curve. So if all you do is use your finger to keep it aligned, take nice long strokes, it will want to follow that line. And notice I'm using that front tooth to scrape it off. And you can tell, see how jagged this outside edge is? I'm scraping across the grain, but because I have that knife line here, I got a nice crisp line on that side. So I will just continue sawing until I hit my stop point. At which point, I've got the entire saw plate in the kerf, and I'm going to rotate my wrist a little bit to put a little more pressure on that front tooth and just make it go deeper. I came out of it right there because I was looking up at my camera. It's hard to film and woodwork at the same time. Now, if you're apprehensive about the termination spot, just mortise in that little relief area down there and then just get after it. I just find sawing so much faster than any other way. Well, we got all the parts and they're ready to assemble. I'm putting a little paste wax on the interior parts, and I went ahead and finished planed them all so they're nice and smooth, and that we will be done there. I'm just making sure not to put any wax wherever there's going to be glue. I like the citrus shield stuff. It has a nice smell to it. It's a little bit more liquidy than a lot of the other hard paste wax. And I'm using a 3M. It's kind of a plastic steel wool. It's equivalent to 4-aught steel wool. To apply it, just because it lets me work it in, it's kind of the last finishing aspect of the project. And if there is any sawdust generator in it, it kind of plugs up any open pores. Plus, it just has a nice feel to it. I generally like to let it dry overnight, and then I'll buff off any high spots of the wax left off, and it'll give it a nice finish, a nice hard wax finished. Now, in the next episode, because I am going to call it quits for the night and just let this dry overnight, we will assemble it, install the glass, get everything prepped up, and then I'll show you some really cool tips and techniques for dealing with milk paint. I like dealing with milk paint, and I think you'll enjoy the video. Well, I hope you learned a few things, enjoyed the video, had some fun, but please remember, these kind of episodes are subsidized from viewers like you. We have a website where we sell a lot of containers. I make some shop-made tools here. I have past YouTube projects that we put out there. And all those sales help subsidize our video creation. But if there's other ways you want to patronize us, we have some few links on the website that'll help you out there too. Well, I hope you enjoyed this. And remember one last thing. It is always worth the effort to learn, create, and share with others. Y'all be safe and have fun.